Town manager, for those that don't know me, after I speak, you'll never forget. This morning, two robust staff members came in, looking very excited. And they had what was a preview of tonight's presentation, and I loved it. I said, this is terrific. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
They're going to close Haven Street, we're going to put in a bowling alley, all these really good ideas. And they had such depressed looks. I didn't really understand, and then I realized, oh, they're showing me a 1965 version of what this was. So that's how my day started, and I was a little late getting there. I'm a little out of breath, but I have some very exciting news to share that's very timely. Today we bought the post office for economic development. There's a lot more. Not stopping there, we bought the parking lot behind that the bank doesn't need. We bought the office building that was also
I'm going to still hear an audio.
Reading Co-op doesn't want to own the buildings anymore. We bought that. We bought Eastern Bank across the street. Before you get too carried away, you're wondering how can we afford all this? It's really quite easy. I'm glad the deputy chief's here. We have one of the safest communities in Massachusetts.
That's the one I think is
the police department is going to be closed next January. So I wanted to share all that exciting news and say I'm very glad MEPC is a great partner. I can't tell you how easy they make those decisions. Our planning staff is terrific also, and I think you're going to enjoy it.
Hi, everybody. And Matt's our senior economic development planner. And Parker Smith is an intern with us. So here's our agenda for tonight. I'll give an overview of the broader project that I mentioned for which we identify these four priority development areas in Reading. Next, we'll have a presentation on findings from a retail office and residential market analysis that Matt and Amanda performed for the town. We will pause for questions at each part of the agenda, so you can save your questions when we get to that point, it'll be great. And then the bulk of the meeting is really focused on discussion around density and design preferences for development that may occur in these four priority development areas. Some of you here may have noticed that we put these photos up, which are a preview of the images we'll be showing
you
today,
which is
why you picked up one of those.
We're not live, are we?
If anyone did not get a keypad, just raise your hand and we'll make sure to get you one. Does everyone have a keypad? Great.
All right.
So, the goal of this project, as I mentioned, is to develop a strategic economic development action plan for the town. And the outcome will be to identify short and long-term action items and strategies the town can pursue to promote redevelopment in these four priority areas. So that redevelopment may include commercial, it may include office, it may include retail and restaurant uses, it may include some residential as well. So the goal of our work is to have to develop those action items that are in a way that is informed by what the market can support. So we will be presenting findings from market analysis that our staff has performed. So brief introduction, MAPC, we're the regional planning agency for Greater Boston. We serve 101 cities and towns, and one of the ways we maintain communication with our member communities is through subregions. So Reading is a part of the North Suburban Subregion, which Amanda coordinates. We have many divisions at MAPC. We have a land use division, environment, energy, public health. We also have a division on municipal collaboration. So I would note that MAPC is also at this time working with the town of Reading on a streamlined permitting project, identifying ways that processes can be streamlined to ensure that the town is more business friendly. We are also working with the town to examine opportunities for cost savings and for streamlining provision of services. So we have staff in that division that are working with Reading as well. This particular project is funded through several sources of funding, partly through town resources and partly through what's called the District Local Technical Assistance Program, which is money that our agency advocates for annually from the legislature. And it essentially allows us to do planning work for with and for our communities. So, that was the map of our region. So, Reading is along with eight other communities north of Boston that's in North Suburban. So tonight we're focusing discussion on four areas. These four areas are the downtown, what we're calling PDA number one, the downtown 40R district potential expansion area, PDA number two, South Main Street, PDA number three, New Crossing Road Redevelopment District, and PDA number four, One General Way. When you came in, you picked up this handout which presents information on what's currently in each of these areas. This information is drawn from 2013 assessor's data, so it's very current information about the types of development that's currently there, the size of the parcels, and the mix of uses that are in each area. So over the last several months, we've been working with an advisory committee, which I will introduce a little further on, but we've been working closely with a team of local staff and residents of Reading to examine retail office, residential market potential in Reading. So we'll be presenting that tonight. Another component of our work, which will happen after this meeting and will be informed by the feedback you give us later today, we will be doing some scenarios modeling to examine the mix and quantity of development that can be accommodated in the four priority areas. So later today, when we get to the point of asking for your feedback on the suitability of different development types in each of the areas, we will essentially take that information, generate a couple of different scenarios that we can model and run, and we'll come back to you in June, on June 3rd, our next public meeting, present the findings of that, and we'll also be able to share some renderings, some visuals of what that redevelopment potential would look like. So the deliverable to the town by June will be an action plan examining short and long-term steps they can take to facilitate redevelopment in those four areas. And they'll include both policy and planning recommendations. So So our local advisory committee, whom we've met with and spoken to over the last several months, include the town manager, Bob Belusher, Gene Delios, and also Jesse Wilson. And Selectman John Halsey and Kevin Sexton have also been a part of our conversation, as well as members of the Economic Development Committee, and also Lisa from the Chamber of Commerce. So for those who are in the room, if you want to just sort of raise your hand, I'm sure you know these folks already, but we have many of you in the room, so thank you. So about 2 years ago, North Suburban Planning Council, the sub-region of MAPC, initiated a process to create space for regional dialogue about development and preservation priorities. It was a year and a half long project, and it involved, you know, probably a series of, I'd say, maybe 15 to 20 public meetings, both local and regional forums. And the goal of that discussion was to really create space to say, you know, what are our priorities for development and preservation? You know, where are areas in town that, you know, we really want to focus on examining, you know, policy changes or planning changes to really facilitate redevelopment? So we worked with the town to initiate a process to basically screen those areas for suitability for different development types. The town was asked to both identify those areas that they believe are potential for redevelopment, to identify the specific development types they think could be suitable in those locations. So here's a summary of, you know, the options that were provided. You know, mixed use infill, master plan development, multifamily, commercial medical office, commercial retail, entertainment, hospitality, and industrial. So our next step then was to leverage the data that our agency has already access to. MassGIS data, assessor's data, a lot of different sources to examine, you know, based on those development types the town selected, how suitable are these land areas for accommodating that type of development. So here's a brief summary of the types of data sets that we used to examine these areas. So for example, you know, if the town identified an area for being suitable for residential, you know, is it in close proximity to public transit? You know, what's the quality of, you know, what is the sidewalk availability? Is it a high traffic area? Is it near schools? We also looked at other data sets, including open space and healthy watersheds. So looking at, you know, is this area that's been identified for potentially being suitable for commercial, does it fall within an area that is economically, environmentally fragile? You know, does it make sense to actually identify that as an area for commercial or industrial? So, you know, we make use of, you know, available data to inform the information that we then provided to the town. So, you know, we also looked at, you know, data about around employment density, number of businesses, you know, if they've identified this area as potentially being suitable for more, you know, retail or office development. Is there a concentration of other businesses in the area, so you're really supporting, you know, a hub of activity? And also, you know, are they identifying areas where there's zoning that does support growth potential? You know, is there a 40-yard district? You know, Reading has that. So, you know, one of the PDAs, of course, that we identified is adjacent to the current 40-yard district. So here's an aerial map. You can see these much better in your handouts. But these are the areas we're examining tonight. PDA number one is 46 parcels. It's adjacent to the current 40-yard district. And the town is interested in expanding 40-yard zoning to include these parcels. PDA number two, South Main Street Corridor, 26-acre area, consisting of 82 parcels. There currently is a mix of uses, but the town would like to support more mixed use in this area, particularly allowing more retail in the segment of the corridor that is closer to the current corridor. They also identified this corridor as a priority for facilitating streetscape improvements that will enhance experience for pedestrians and bicyclists. PDA number three, New Crossing Road Redevelopment District, is a 5-acre area. It includes vacant lots, derelict buildings, and sites with industrial uses. The area is currently zoned for industrial, and the town is interested in pursuing a change in zoning. PDA number four, One General Way, is one large parcel, 20 acres. It's a mix of single-story commercial uses and has ample parking. The town is interested in facilitating more vibrant mix of uses and structures of different densities. So these are some of the maps you may have seen when you came in, but it's just an overview of the kinds of data we're looking at when examining digging deeper and looking at within each of these priority development areas, what are some of those parcels that, you know, could be priority development? What are some important planning or zoning considerations? So, you know, like land use, PDA number 4, currently zoned industrial use. The corridor, you know, has a mix of residential and also retail and commercial. And the PDA expansion area does include predominantly residential uses.
May we ask questions as we're going through this, or did you
I'm actually through? Going to pause for questions, so you just hold on. Current zoning. So I'll keep moving because I want to make sure I keep moving questions. All of the priority development areas are within a half mile walking distance of the Reading commuter rail station. So now we're getting into some of the data that we're also collecting to better understand each of the parcels within the PDAs. Floor area ratio is just a way of understanding the density of the structures that are on each of the parcels. Building value per square foot, one way of understanding which parcels have structures that have the potential of being redeveloped to be of higher value. Tax revenue per parcel. This also is a way of identifying parcels that have the potential for redevelopment to bring in more tax revenue. Improvements to land value ratio. This essentially looks at the value of the buildings and the value of other improvements to the parcel divided by the value of the land. So it's one way of understanding parcels that have the potential for redevelopment for accommodating a higher, more dense, and more profitable use. So we can see, for example, PDA number 4, One General Way, a very large parcel that has a relatively low value. The land value is 1 to 2 times higher than the building value. And that's true for many of the parcels within the 4 priority development areas. So questions?
Just a brief question. Does high tech fall within industrial?
High tech would be under commercial office.
Yeah, that would be more of an office use, like you're saying, tech workers, things like that.
No, I was thinking things like server farms and whatnot that are a whole different definition of it's not manufacturing, it's service provider.
That'd be kind of like a light industrial use. It would fall into that kind of.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Are those maps available?
Yes, so we can post them on the project website. So you'll see the URL on the bottom of your handout, mapc.org/readingeactionplan. So after the meeting, we can post the maps on there. Any other questions before we move on?
Will you be talking to the scenarios you'll be running to show whether it's maximization of tax revenues or can you have algorithms that do that with all the different mixes that you've shown here?
Yeah, so what emerges from our conversation later today and the keypad polling combined will inform the different scenarios that we'll set up the model to run. So we use ArcGIS CommunityViz, and it's basically an extension that allows you to do scenario modeling based on placing developments of different densities with different mixes of use.
I see.
So we'll come back to you in June with some numbers and information that will be directly informed by what you tell us today.
Okay. So the 4 areas that you're focusing on, you said these were recommended or by the town specifically, they weren't identified by your analysis, correct?
So the initial 4 areas, so the process was we had an initial meeting with town staff to have a broad conversation of development and preservation priorities. There was probably a list that was 2 or 3 times the size what you're looking at of priority development and preservation areas. Then we had a public process where I believe we presented at a board of a planning commission meeting
and locally,
and board of selectmen. We came twice to Reading to present, and those were televised. And then we also had several regional forums. So then the data sets that I shared, the groupings of those data sets, we then applied our screen examining suitability for these areas to accommodate these different development types. And, you know, there was a process of also looking at what did the other communities outside of Reading identify? You know, which of these areas have the infrastructure for, you know, the existing, you know, a number of, you know, what are these, you know, what are, looking at the context of Reading and the context of the region, you know, what types, what areas rise to the top as being most capable of supporting redevelopment and having the infrastructure and assets to support that. So it was a long process, and there was a lot of communication with staff and also with the forums.
Does that mean there's a longer list of like 5, 6, 7, and 8 that are also could be considered but are not being considered at this point?
Yes. So we actually have that on our website. I can, if you're interested, I can include a link to that longer report. In the appendices, it does include all the other areas that the town initially identified. So Jesse Wilson from the town was involved in that process. So if you have questions too about
if you have specific questions about the report, you know, you can definitely give me the report to look over. And if you have any questions in your general, we'd be happy to answer them.
Yeah, so I'm just going to get the website.
Yeah. Okay. Can we go back to the picture of the one? I was just wondering about which one of these areas are most residential right now. I think it's one, but I didn't know. Do you mind going back
one
that
and
way?
Two. 1A and 2 are the areas in town that currently have a lot of residential.
Oh no, this one land use, so it shows like one is, so if I'm reading it right, the yellow in 1A would probably be the biggest concentration of residential right now.
Presently. So okay. I believe this is Mass Janus data, which is a bit dated.
Okay.
I believe the data set is from 2007. So we get this from the state. Data that's supplied by cities and towns to the state. So maybe a bit outdated, but mostly accurate.
Okay. Thank you.
So if you have no other questions, we'll transition to the next part.
Is the overall goal to maximize tax revenue? Is that what we're trying to do here? Or
it sort of fits into a larger discussion around, you know, how do we advance quality of life for the people who live, work, and play in Reading. And, you know, based on current assets, you know, how can the town adopt, you know, policies, programs, zoning changes to facilitate redevelopment that's in line with the town's vision.
So it's broader than just tax revenue. Right.
It's you know, that's one way to examine parcels for redevelopment potential is to look at that last, you know, so data like this is informative to the discussion, but you know, there are other things we can look at. You know, other data sets we may look at include, you know, the age of structures in town. So, if you want to add anything else.
Yeah. Yeah, I think what's really important is, and I'll talk about this a little bit when I go over the market analysis findings, but when there is that market, just being very proactive about thinking through where you want development to take place, and then, you know, therefore concentrating that development in certain areas is also preserving other areas for different uses. So it's just really being proactive in the planning process. So
it's like, I mean, really it becomes about managing growth the way the community wants that growth to be directed. So really it's looking at all the different data and all the different scenarios and really understanding what the community is interested in. That's what a lot of the information we're going to gather from the later exercises.
And just to follow on that, selectmen for the last year have formed a group that was called Reading 2020. We weren't looking for the Olympics. Those groups, part of one of the missions of those groups is to gather a lot of background and data and community input. There's absolutely been no decision made about what the most important thing. So we need to know what the options are first before we can go to that step.
Sorry, another question. Does the Planning Commission have its own agenda or other goals that have nothing to do with Reading, or is it just a resource for communities? Do you have an agenda, or are you just adopting Reading's agenda, whatever that might be?
No, I mean, I guess I went a little fast in our earlier slide, but we have a regional plan through till 2035 that charts out values and goals and objectives around how we believe the region should grow and how we can also discuss the preservation. So we do have a regional plan, and all of our work is guided by and in support of advancing those values, which, you know, I think many of us can agree to and subscribe to, which is that we want all the communities that we live in to have many access to many types of opportunities for many different types of people. So that includes access to different types of commercial opportunities, restaurants, retail options, options for different types of businesses to locate here, options for people of different, at different points in their lives, and different types of housing situations from seniors to young people. Really thinking bigger picture about how do we facilitate that development that's in line with that regional plan and vision. Any other questions?
I could jump in. Hi, everybody. I'm Jean Delio. So I think what we're going to try and get to tonight is a discussion of density and the visualization of when we talk about redevelopment and economic development, everyone thinks, oh, let's, you know, be like Burlington and have these big office buildings. That's one type of economic development. There's a whole bunch of other things that are nuanced in mixed use and other types of commercial and other types of land uses. So what we're trying to do tonight is really think about what does development look like for Reading? What's the Reading type of development that we want to see, that we're comfortable with? So when I tell you, you know, we've had a little slide there about the FAR and the density of the buildings to the site, you know, okay, what does that look like? We're going to actually see pictures. See, this is kind of what we're talking about when we say redevelopment of this type. So that's what we're driving towards to the end. So stay tuned for those visualizations, and everyone's going to get to vote, so hopefully it'll be fine.
Great, so with that, I'll turn it over to Amanda.
Okay. Hi everyone, I'm Amanda Chisholm. I'm a regional planner at MAPC. As Jen mentioned, one of the major components of this project was to do a market analysis. So we looked at retail opportunities, office opportunities, as well as residential opportunities. And I'm going to be presenting the retail and office side, and then I'll turn it over to my colleague Matt, who will talk about the residential market opportunities. And one thing to just keep in mind with this is that this is the potential market. It's not a projection. We're not saying this is definitely going to happen. It's just something that's out there, and then the town has to really decide what of that they want to capture. So the first piece that's really important in any market analysis is to really get that local context. So we start out by actually going out to the community, talking with business owners, retailers, speaking with commercial brokers, residential brokers, to hear from them, because they're the ones that are operating in this market all of the time. And some of the things that we heard from retailers, high level here, we heard that most retail businesses were doing well. There are some that are struggling. There's not a whole lot of retail turnover, and there's low vacancy downtown, so that's a good thing. Rents are pretty competitive. So those three things are, you know, working in favor of maybe supporting some additional retail. We heard on the challenge side that downtown parking can be confusing and that sometimes that may deter customers from coming to the retail downtown. We also heard that in some cases the town could be more business friendly in terms of communication or supporting the business community and further streamlining the business process. We also asked about residential to see what businesses thought, and many of them felt like residential would be a good thing to help increase their customer base. Highlights from the interviews with commercial brokers. There's some potential for additional small professional offices downtown. Those spaces seem to be in demand. Also maybe some potential for limited new office development. The market for retail is mostly going to be small local stores. There's a lot of strong regional retail competition because of where Reading is located. Market Street at Linfield is one example that comes up a lot. There's also a lot of strong office competition. So Jean talked about Burlington, Woburn. These are some major players in the office market. Reading does have really strong community, demographics, great access to transportation. So there are definitely things that commercial brokers would be looking for that are here. So if Reading is interested in pulling from that market, there's going to be some opportunity, which I'll get into later. The residential brokers, we heard that single family or alternatives, which would be like townhomes, for example, that market is very strong. But there's also a demand for well-located multifamily housing. So multifamily housing that is in a walkable area, an amenity-rich area, that's the kind of housing that people are looking for. So these are the retail analysis findings. I just wanted to present a little bit of context in terms of how we approach this. So the first thing that's really important in doing a retail analysis is identifying the trade area. So the trade area is basically going to be the area where a retail business can expect to draw sales from. And one factor we consider when determining the trade area is the distance that people need to travel in order to get to that retail. So this is actually a graphic of drive times. So you can see the study areas in the middle here. The green outline here is a 5-minute drive time. The red is a 10-minute drive time. And then the blue is actually a 15-minute drive time. So in addition to considering travel time, we'll also look at what the regional competition is in terms of retail. We'll consider if there are any physical barriers to access. And for a downtown area like Reading, and also for these PDAs, which are so close to that downtown area, it's reasonable to assume that people would be willing to travel at least 10 minutes to reach the retail here. So we use that as our primary trade area. We also looked at a secondary trade area of 15 minutes. This is especially important for things like restaurants, which tend to draw people from a little further away. So we wanted to see, you know, how much additional retail you capture if you look at that secondary trade area. So this is just a quick summary of the retail gap analysis. Once we have that trade area defined, we look at the residential spending power within the area, and we compare that with the actual sales of goods and services. So that's the demand versus the supply. And when that demand actually exceeds supply, there's an opportunity to support additional retail. So the summary here, by primary trade area, the 10-minute drive time, all the reds are represent no opportunity or limited opportunity in terms of the market. There's an opportunity for one food or beverage store. This would likely be like a specialty grocery store to complement what's already here, because you do have some major grocery stores already. Health and personal care, a couple establishments. Miscellaneous store retailers, which includes things like used merchandise, florists, pet shops, food services and drinking places, one establishment. So for a total of 6 potential supported establishments within the PDAs. When you go out to the 15-minute drive time, you see that the actual market potential doesn't change a whole lot except for here, which is actually really good news because, as I mentioned before, restaurants is something that tends to draw people in from further away. So that does represent an opportunity if the town is interested in pursuing it. So if Reading does capture some of this market for retail, here are some strategies to consider in terms of the 4 PDAs. First of all, you want to make sure you're filling in those downtown vacancies, so the Walgreens, the Quiznos, making sure that you're activating those areas that are currently empty. Concentrating the majority of new retail downtown would be important because the opportunities are really downtown inclined retail sectors. You could also probably put some in the northern end of South Main Street because these PDAs are so close together. That would be complementary to downtown without really pulling away from the business area. Again, a focus on restaurants. We saw that that was an opportunity, especially for downtown, and an opportunity for some additional retail may be there if you're willing to also increase that residential to support those businesses. So in terms of office analysis findings, this is the office outlook. These are numbers from Jones Lang LaSalle. And what we're looking at here is the Boston North market compared to the 128 Mass Pike market and then the suburbs overall. So you can see the north here. That's where Reading is located. I'm comparing it to 128 Mass Pike because this is a really thriving suburban market so that you can see how the North Market does versus 128, and then the suburban average. So some of the things we're looking at, the average asking rent is a little low at about $20 versus 28 and 128, but it's on par with the suburbs in general. Year-over-year rent growth, however, is keeping pace with 128, so that may be an indicator that the market is improving. Total vacancy we also consider. Typically you want to see between a 5% and 10% vacancy rate for a really thriving office market. So the north is a little high at about 15%, but good news is that it's below the historical average and that it's going down. And then lastly, the total absorption, which in Boston North is actually higher than 128. So in sum, the market is improving. It's not quite a thriving suburban market, but there may be some opportunities for office development. The other piece we consider is these are the NAICS industry projections. These are done by the Mass Department of Workforce and Labor Development, or Workforce Development and Labor. And basically, these are only the office inclined sectors. So we're looking at sectors that would traditionally locate in an office building. And again, this is at a regional level. So we can see that this region, which is the Metro North Workforce Investment Area, includes Reading. And it also is, there's a projection of about a 14.7% growth. So 31,000 jobs to be added by 2022. That's a significant amount of jobs. But again, this region includes Burlington, it includes Cambridge, it includes Woburn, so you're gonna have a lot of strong regional competition. So if Reading really wants to grab some of this, they're gonna have to market themselves. I mentioned some of the assets earlier, the access to transportation, the mixed use, strong demographics, those are the kind of things that would work in Reading's favor. So quickly in sum here, small professional offices in downtown and South Main Street, there's definitely demand for those. New office space as part of some of the larger parcels at One General Way or on New Crossing Road. Build-to-suit's likely gonna be your best opportunity, so that means you're actually building an office space for a tenant that you've already secured. That way you have a secure tenant and you have a much higher chance of getting financing for that project as well. And then a large office tenant could be supported by the regional market, but there's a lot of competition, so there's gotta be a really clear strategy for attracting that if that's a priority. So I'm gonna turn it over to Matt.
Hi everybody. Again, my name is Matt Smith and I'm the Senior Economic Development Planner at MAPC. And I focus a lot on this market analysis piece, but then also comprehensive economic development strategies. I'm just gonna go through some of the residential analysis. And these are gonna be the broad, I would say, findings from this, because there's a lot of detail that goes into this analysis, which will be very much detailed within the report. So I just wanted to kind of just add that to discussing them. When you're looking at housing, really looking at the future, it's the growth in households or the decline, if you're in a shrinking area, that's going to drive that housing demand. MAPC does household projections throughout our region, both through 2020 and 2030. And what we're showing is that over the next 10 to 20 years, or 2030, Reading's projected to have about 1,900 additional households. The most significant growth is going to be, and this is what this box is right here, in those households that are headed by someone 65 years or older. This is common throughout our region, and this is happening throughout, I would say, all the state of Massachusetts and the Northeast. It's very common. However, there's also, based on the projections, and this is looking at mobility rates, people moving in, moving out, you actually are projected to get an increase in households, not a huge one, but in the 20 to 34 segment, that the millennials that everyone keeps talking about. So it's interesting, that's where your growth is gonna be, in the older population and in the younger population. Interestingly enough, those 35 to 54, most likely the kids, is about projected to be remain amount stable over time. So that's interesting. Interestingly enough, the growth, seniors and millennials have very similar housing choices. They're aligning for the first time, really. And there's a far greater interest in, I would say, smaller housing units, often in walkable, mixed-use areas. This is happening throughout the region. So that's going to be your market. The future market is really these smaller households who are looking for walkability, the retail, and everything. We wanted to kind of look though and understand what the market's going to be in the future. So we were looking at recent trends. And in general, you are an owner-occupied community. 80% of your households are owner-occupied, 20%. And that's remained relatively stable. However, we did notice over the last 10 to 15 years or so, there has been a slight shift starting to happen. There's been slightly more rentals. And though it's not a lot when you look at the actual overall percentage here, it went from 83 to 81 owner, 17 to 19 rental. But here's what's interesting. So even though you gained more owner-occupied housing, it only grew by 4% over that time frame, but rental grew by 211, which is a 14% increase. So you're seeing there is a greater interest in rental housing, and that's actually another regional trend that's happening. So that's something to consider when you're actually thinking of your future housing stock. Another thing, condominiums are really increasingly popular. What we did is we looked at data, this is actually from Mass Department of Revenue, the Division of Local Services. They track different parcels and what type of uses are on it. What's really interesting here is when you look at single family housing, you did get these are net gains over since 2015, 88 additional units, which actually is an overall percentage is down. Multifamily, these are the small 2 to 3 family multifamily, they're actually down a little bit, you've lost 45, probably because they've been converted to condos. We've had a big gain in condominiums, 464 net new units over the last 15 years. That's a significant change. And this is actually speaking to those changing housing preferences, particularly as we see an aging population. And this is actually what was actually supported in a lot of the interviews. And then apartments, these are the larger apartments. There's been 7 additional large apartment structures, and so that might also be kind of responsible for that increase in rentals. This is very interesting. So this is the number of sales and prices. This is the big recession. You saw the big dip. You are now at all-time highs in terms of sales, but also prices. Condominiums in particular, speaking of what we just talked, your number of sales are up 256 6% since the bottom in 2008, and the prices have increased 33%. That's significant. While there's been increases in single family, the sales are up 42%. So it's significantly lower percentage-wise, and your prices are up 21%. So the real rise has been in the condominium market, so that these are very desirable units. Broker we spoke with talked about single family without a doubt being the highest demand, and the schools here were one of the things that people did mention. However, it is important to say throughout the region, and as this millennial, which is this big boom in age, the projection of younger people is, or students people is projected to go down over the next 10 to 15, 20 years actually. So that's something to consider. The condo market is also strong here. In particular, it's those upscale two bedroom units that are very popular. Some of the comments that you hear when we talk to people throughout the region is that it's a lot of times it is kind of empty nesters, people who are downsizing, but still want an extra bedroom if like a grandchild comes to visit. So those are popular units. Even the burglary said, some people do tend to move away when their kids leave the school system. And they'd like to stay in Reading, but unfortunately some find that they don't like the location of the current condominiums. They are kind of on the outskirts of town. There's nothing walkable with many of them. So that's where they see the demand. There's just not the, I would say the markets actually fill it right now in the downtown area. So that's important to think about. Commuter rail is very important and is a big attractor. It's one of the great amenities of this community. There hasn't been a lot of single family construction going on. You actually don't have a lot of land available for single family. So that is another factor that's actually increasing the prices and competition. And then rentals, when they are coming, they come and go very quickly. There is definitely demand there. In general, the inventory is older. So when actually newer units come up, they are in high demand and they can command some pretty significant prices. 30 Haven Street is actually a good example of that. So really, the residential market opportunities. When you look over, you don't want to look more beyond 10 years really for a projection when you're, or a potential for housing, because the market could change. So we look more about the 2020-2025 timeframe. Townwide, there could be a demand for 950 total units. And that's a mixture of single family, multifamily. That's townwide. So that's another thing. In looking at trends, the majority are going to be owner-occupied. You're not going to see this massive shift from the 80-20 split about what you have, but maybe you'll see some differentiation, increasing a few more rentals and things like that. So that's something to consider. That's going to be really constrained in the single family by the limited vacant available land that's actually zoned for that as well. You're not going to get thousands of units of single family housing here. Most development will be infill and redevelopment. That's the kind of parcels we're talking about here. These are these parcels, really they're all downtown or downtown inclined. They're all walkable. They're all next to your amenity-rich downtown area. So that's really important to think about. And so based on what we also saw, there is strong demand for units in these types of environments. So that's what we focused on for this project. So that's the 950 is the total demand to townwide. So then we did a breakdown and we looked at the splits. Given the size of the parcels and things like that, and the preference for multifamily units that are in a walkable area, there's a lot of math behind this, but approximately about half the demand could occur down in the downtownish area. So that winds up being about 300 multifamily units could be supported. We're not predicting this will happen. This is what the market could likely support. That's important to remember. And then it would be a combination of condominiums and rentals. As we said, we're seeing more rentals. Rentals are becoming increasingly popular as well. But really, the market's going to demand that. And those who will develop are going to determine if it's going to be a rental or a condominium. That's just the way the market works. And then we kind of see that there's a market for the single family alternatives, those townhouse, row house environments that are really incorporated into, I would say, larger redevelopment projects. And this kind of appeals to, like, so I was saying, some of those downsizing households who are looking for maybe that extra bedroom or two, maybe want a little bit more room as well. So in total, about 410 units could be the market. If you actually want a comparison, it's Reading Woods. That's actually permitted for over 400 units total. 424. So that's that one development. These are far larger areas when you think about that, and that all is happening over just a couple of years. So that's the market demand that we found. And you know, just again, remember all of these are in this walkable environment. They are all these downtown inclined, as we like to say, populations who would be interested in living there. So, questions for Amanda and I? Do we do questions here or we do the development first?
Sorry.
We're going to go over the development and the comments actually, where we feel the different types of housing and where each other go. So, sorry about that. So, focusing in on area one. This is the the downtown, which would be the 40R expansion area. Really, this is where you want to concentrate those retail opportunities that Amanda spoke of, health and personal care. those are those kind of things people want in a walkable environment, that they can kind of do one parking or they live there and just go from place to place. Restaurants in particular hold that, the draw there. You already have several, and restaurants tend to do better in clusters, really target that there. In terms of residential, this would predominantly be a multifamily situation, similar to, you know, that's where Haven Street went in the 40R, where you can have those smaller units and people can walk out their door and get to places. Also mixed use environments. And then office, this is not going to be a place where you're going to get large office development. It will be probably professional offices, things like, you know, like a lawyer or an accountant that would be in an upper floor most likely. So that's what your opportunity is there. For the second priority development area, which is on South Main Street, which you can see, it's very large. Really, the opportunities that we identified in the market are really more those downtown. So really what we're thinking about, it's going to be focusing, in particular, mostly on the northern section in terms of, you know, the retail. You've got the nice concentration of your downtown already. It's kind of extending that. It could create a nice gateway. There's already retail there, and that would be incorporated in the square footage within any redevelopment, but it could be a really nice way to extend that downtown. In terms of, you also want to then phase new commercials, so there could be opportunities as more households are there to support more retail. Again, every household will bring more spending potential to the area. In terms of residential, multifamily to the north, really up here, and then you could actually get some more infill, maybe townhouse, row houses throughout as the market demands. And then office, again, small professional. You're not likely to see a large office development. The parcels won't accommodate it.
Okay, so for PDA number 3, which is the New Crossing Road Redevelopment District, which is located here in yellow, again, because this is so close to the downtown area, again, within just a half mile walk of the commuter rail station, it could support some residential, but could also support some office. It's a really interesting site right now. It's very industrial. So in terms of office, there's some opportunities to get a little creative, maybe incorporate some light industrial along with the residential, do some office flex space. So you could have a really interesting and creative development. Single family alternatives could be a part of this as well. So again, those row houses, those townhomes that we were talking about. And then the fourth PDA, this is One General Way. This is gonna be your best potential because it's one of the larger parcels if you are interested in drawing in that office. Again, build to suit is probably that best potential so that you have that guaranteed tenant that can help with the financing. If you wanted to, you could put residential here to blend with the surrounding areas. You can see that there's residential right here, so it might be a nice kind of buffer between any office that would be developed. Mixed-use areas in general, that's really the big draw for a lot of commercial developers these days because they know that workers prefer that, and they know that companies know that workers prefer that, so commercial developers are definitely considering that when they're choosing where to locate. So if you can incorporate that variety of uses, again, they're all so close together, that will only help to attract more commercial developers. Again, that's a priority. Okay, so now we're gonna take questions.
When you guys do your analysis, is one of the pieces you'll look at for each of the things that you laid out the impact on townwide services that each command? So for example, putting in 900 new housing units, I think would have a big impact on certain services. Is that part of the analysis that we'll be able to look at when we do the comparisons as well?
So when we did the community visualization process, which Jen referenced, so we'll be getting feedback from all of you on these development types, and then we'll be running these models. And there are definitely a variety of factors we could look at. So if you put in X number of housing units, I think that you can look at how that would impact the services as well. I don't know specifically, Jen, if you want to talk more about it, but it does give you just a general sense of, I think.
I don't have a list of all the detailed indicators or information that it's been sent. You know, wastewater generation is one. I can
traffic impact, we'll look at stormwater. So different impacts of development that the town would need to manage.
Tax revenue generation.
Yep. If there is a way to incorporate kind of the draw on services, I think that would be very helpful.
I think it's important to know, like, yeah, at this stage, the market analysis is looking at the potential supportable, and then exactly, once you can see that and how it can be allocated, depending on what the different preferences are, then you're more likely to be able to understand the different, you know, services. It's just not there yet.
I had a question, kind of building on what he said, impact on services, and I'm asking about the impact on schools. One of the notes I took from your presentation said, you're projecting the student population in Reading to decline. Where does that data come from?
That's actually coming from our regional projections in terms of what's happening with, it's over the time. There's actually, I think, a slight increase over the initial peak phase and then a decrease. And that's based on the population and housing trends, very detailed modeling that goes into the projections, and it's everything from the age over time and history, but then also of those different populations moving through different life stages and the number of children that are likely to be born, moving in, moving out, things like that. So that's where that comes from. So that's a regional, it's also a regional number. The number of student of school-age children is expected to decline throughout the region, really after 2020.
So when you project, just to follow up, you're projecting two-bedroom units are unlikely to generate new students for the schools in these districts?
I would say you're not going to get any students in those units. That's not realistic. But they are more likely to attract, I would say, senior, smaller households, households that maybe have one kid beginning, things like that. They don't typically attract as many students.
Well, I'm curious. I don't know if the team has data with Redding Woods and Redding Commons. You know, a lot of those were sold to the town as low impact on the schools, and I don't know how many. I personally know students from each place, so I don't know how many they've added, but I would ask that you add that consideration
to
the data.
I think the reality too. What?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're well aware that Reading schools are great and that people are attracted here and that families are attracted here. And, you know, as people are aging, which we're seeing, there's going to be a huge aging population. They're going to leave those single family homes. And Reading has a really large single family housing stock. So that trend of families moving here is going to continue. The good thing about a multifamily development, if it doesn't necessarily bring in the students at the same rate, is that those are more people that are paying taxes, that are then helping to support those services, which includes the schools as well. So, I mean, it's a give and take, right? Like, I'm sure that many of you are proud of the fact that you have great schools here, but it's a draw on the fiscal side in terms of the town. So we're sort of balancing, you know, the competing priorities. But yes, those are great points. So
Let me add something.
Yeah.
When we look at things like Johnson Wards or some of the larger developments, there's all kinds of math to tell you how many kids, and generally the math is right, and in Reading's case, it's generally right. But the important thing is the secondary effect. Who's selling their homes to move into these places? Because they're older and they don't have kids, but who are they selling their homes to? So there's a second tier effect of, you know, what else is going on? Because if seniors trying to downsize are moving to these kinds of units and they're selling their homes to families with 25 kids, so that's the data that's a lot harder to capture. And this data here is regional again. You know, Reading is different. But the overall trends are quite clear that there should be or will be less kids.
I think it's also important to note that a lot of these housings we're talking about, there's a lot of talk about, you know, aging in place. And where a lot of people think that means aging in that same house, a lot of people just want to age in their community. But currently, if someone's looking to downsize in Reading, there really aren't opportunities for those smaller units right now. There's some, but there's not a large. And that really did, oh, Gina.
Yeah, I have the data, Jesse just pulled it up. So for 30 Haven Street, the old Atlantic supermarket, we have seven students. That's 53 units of housing. And for Reading Woods, we have
eight
students from Reading. This is from January of 2015. So that's 400, not quite full build-up, but it's a couple hundred units already occupied at Reading Woods. It's exactly what the model says, that the people moving in are empty nesters and younger folks just starting out. And those folks have very little impact on children in the school system. It's true here in Reading, and it's true throughout the region. That's what we see. To Bob's point, the people that are selling their house, that's a different story. But when these units get built, the people moving in are downsizing or just starting out.
And the families are moving with family members back here.
Yep.
Closer.
Yes. Yep. If I could just say their name before a question, that would be really helpful.
Yeah, hi. I'm George Rio. Can you go back a couple slides to the section, the parcel 1A, I guess the boundary?
This one?
Yeah, right there. So I was curious, if you look at sort of 1A, the westernmost, I guess you would say, corner of that parcel,
Here?
Yeah. Why was that sort of cut off? Why wouldn't it be logical just to run it down? I guess that would be Haven Street and High Street, like up that corner.
Yeah, so basically the way
this... Or is it already zoned that way?
Yes. So the PDA was defined around the actual existing boundary of the 40R district. So that's why it kind of has this weird shape.
So the rest of that is already 40R. Okay.
Yes.
Got it.
So this would be what
that's
could potentially add to the
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, I guess a complimentary to Mark's question on infrastructure or town demand on town services is also the reality of the impact on traffic, and not on traffic, but pedestrians. If we want to have housing, say, along the northern South Main and in that and crossing development, the reality is that's a messy, ugly place down there. Mm-hmm. And crossing over to the train station and to the bus stop and everything is nasty. It's not really walkable. We have sidewalks, but it's extremely congested, very hazardous. It'd be nice to have those things, and it's ugly to walk through that area too. It's very unappealing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it'd have to be a lot to to make that actually work other than throwing a building or something.
Yeah.
And that's really important. I mean, this is a market analysis, and that's the important part of it. This is a potential, but there's far more pieces that come into play of whether something's going to be successful. So exactly, in order to make, you know, take advantage of that opportunity if you so choose to, there's going to be public realm improvements, you know, crossings of the 28. You know, that's really important because that's your trip over to the train station. That's your trip to it. So that's part of it. So that's going to have to be a larger, I would say, multi-pronged, I would say, strategy. Okay, first maybe you need to do some of those public improvements, or, you know, when they're redeveloped, you know, there's certain design criteria that are required, things like that, which actually is incorporated into a 40R district, which is really great. But you can also incorporate that into, you know, other developments as well. So that's an important thing about and would be needed.
Yeah. Maybe it's a later stage, but to me, I look at downtown, like near the commuter rail station, it looks like there's a lot of possibilities, but you have some buildings that don't seem to bring much value, or relatively little value, given how important that land is right around it. Like you mentioned, there's a moving place, we'll mention the name right across the way, it's kind of an ugly looking thing. And all I can think of is, boy, you can have a mixed-use thing right there. Because the impact in the neighborhood, I mean, it'd be better than having that building.
Yeah.
So is that going to be part of it? How do you work with the community?
I mean, part of what we're looking at, and if you want to take a look at some of these maps too, is so those different indicators. So where is, you know, the building value not so high? Maybe that might be a good opportunity for redevelopment. But of course, you always have to work with property owners and talk with them to see if that's potential. So we'll be doing that kind of analysis to kind of drill down, especially within South Main Street and downtown, you know, what parcels do hold that potential based on things like value.
That's also part of the option sometimes of rezoning. Sometimes that's a message to like the development community or the community itself or property owners that there is the potential and the desire to see an area transition to a different use or a higher value use. So that can actually increase the value of the land that's currently holding, I would say, which is a use that someone feels maybe underutilized, and therefore like more likely to redevelop it. So it's just one piece, because again, it is the private property owner who also has a say. So that's, if they don't want to redevelop, then you know, sometimes it's incentives that are needed to actually encourage or which isn't that. But that's part of the whole process.
Yep.
One of the things, I don't know, looked at, but one of the things that I've seen that's kind of a detriment is that a lot of these parcels you're talking about, especially in 1A and maybe some of the other places north of Main on Main Street, they're very small parcels, so they're very hard to develop into anything. And I think that's one of the hazards in town is you've got multiple tiny landowners, and to try to assemble a parcel to do any kind of significant redevelopment on an economical scale is a problem. And I don't know if that's something that you're seeing region-wide or more unique to this town or whatever. How, you know,
that's common.
How do you address that? I mean, that's one of the problems.
That's common in a lot of particularly in downtown environments, which we actually do quite a bit of work on. And there are different strategies. You can have parcel assemblies sometimes with zoning, which you allow greater densities on larger parcels, things like that, greater heights. So those are things that, you know, once we get to the actual plan portion of this and the strategies, what we can be doing is working with the town in the next meeting, maybe some of these different strategies that might encourage that. So it's there's so many different approaches, but that's true. When you have small parcels, that's one of the greatest challenges. And sometimes that's, you know, sometimes there almost needs to understand the value of that land that might make it more likely for different people to sell to one owner, or like even if it's an existing property, to buy a neighboring parcel, things like that. But it's a challenge, without a doubt, without a doubt.
I think we're out of time. We have to get to the fun part. Questions. Okay. So we're just going to switch our presentation over to the next part. So I noticed that people came in after we had started. Do you raise your hand if you don't have a keypad? Okay. You'll see
them
attempt to understand what you believe is suitable and appropriate for these priority development areas. So the images are grouped by priority development area. And I'll pause to make sure I know there's room to sort of, you know, refresh our memories of the area that we're talking about. And you may want to refer back to your if you're forgetting sort of where we are in terms of what area we're discussing. So first, to get us comfortable with the polling device, I'm going to ask a couple of demographic questions that are really just a part of our process of making sure that we're doing appropriate outreach to ensure that we're attracting individuals to come to these meetings that are representative of Reading. So with that, here's our first polling question. What is your age? It's anonymous information. Each slide will be shown for probably 20 seconds, and then we'll start a 10-second countdown, which is your reminder to quickly get your vote in. So if you could select your entry. Number 1, 0 to 19, number 2, 20 to 29, 3, 30 to 39, number 4, 40 to 49, number 5, 30 to 59, number 6, 60 to 69, and number 7, 70 or better.
If anyone makes a mistake, you can re-enter it. It only remembers the last one that you hit.
So. Yes. Final answer. I think we have more than 5 minutes. So, for those of you who haven't voted yet, please try the clicker. And I'm going to start the countdown. So, if you have 10 seconds left, there's some diversity in terms of the spread of people by age in this room. So the largest age group is 50 to 59. Next question: how do you identify yourself? White, black, or African American, Hispanic, or Latino, Asian? You'll see numbers and letters, so just look closely at your keypad. These demographic ones have about 5 or 6 options, but moving forward, you will only press 1 or 2 for A or B. So it'll be a little easier. All right, so starting 10 seconds.
Pretty phenomenal.
What language do you speak at home? Okay, I'm going to start the timer. Number one, you own a single family. Number two, you own a multifamily. Number three, you own a condo or townhouse. Number four, you rent. Five, other. Start the timer. So, get your vote in if you haven't yet. So majority of folks in the room own a single family. What's your household income? 0 to 14,999, 15 to 24,999, 25 to 34,999, 35 to 49, 50 to 74,9, 75 to 99,9, 100,000 to 149,9, and 150,000 to 1.
Don't be shy.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I love the height, like the building,
it's just very traditional looking. I like it.
I like it.
Mm-hmm. Quality materials?
Not too high.
Not too high? Just three stories?
It's very open looking. Windows.
Mm-hmm. Lots of windows.
Walking and parking, both of them.
Mm-hmm.
On the north side of the street.
On the, sorry, say it again?
On the north side of the street. It helps a great deal in the window and shadowing and walking in the winter and stuff like that.
Many uses.
The uses?
Many uses.
Many uses. Uses.
Like the size of the sidewalks. For example, we're walking.
Parking right beside the road.
The glass windows are welcoming as you can see what's inside, so you're drawn in rather than pull off on the other side of the wall.
Thank you. So we would like to collect exactly this range of information about why you like or don't like some of the images. So
with that. Quickly, what we're going to do, so we'll, Amanda and myself, will be writing these different comments down so that we have more information than just the basic yes or no. And this will help.
So the first set of images is for, in reference to PA number one, the proposed 40-yard extension area. Proposed, you know, in terms of opportunities we've identified, could be suitable for more mixed-use infill that would include retail, restaurant, office, on upper floors, and multifamily residential. So here's our first image. It's a three-story mixed-use development with retail on the first level. Just so you know, you can start voting now even before I start the countdown, but I'd love to hear some comments on why people are voting yes or no.
It would be nice if there was a little more, I mean, it doesn't really look like there's much of a sidewalk, and it doesn't look like there's any trees, but
it's not really tall. The signage isn't very nice.
Well,
it's not uniform. It's
too many dormers.
The scale of the element is more than the mass.
Part above the window looks sort of dirty. It doesn't look,
Poor signage.
5 more seconds for comments before I start.
It's got multi-use, which is nice.
Mixed use is nice. I'm going to start the countdown, so if you haven't voted yet, please get your vote in.
Is that mixed use there? Are those supposed to be apartments?
There are apartments above, yes. It's actually condos. So this actually has 35 condos in it.
Wow.
Yeah, very nice.
You know where it is?
Let's go.
It's in Lexington. So most of you said no, you do not think this would be this type of job, would be a particular style. So here's the next photo. This is residential.
Please.
Like trees. The windows.
The proportions of the building are better.
The proportion of the building?
Yeah.
3 stories?
No, just window to wall ratio, et cetera.
Window to wall ratio?
Appropriate. Mm-hmm.
Got some breeze.
The offset of the building is nice.
Offset of the building?
Yeah.
The arch is really
nice. Say that.
I just said it'd be nice in the right spot.
Nice in the right location within PDA number one?
Yeah.
Is that a reuse?
It's a nice mix of reuse and new.
This is a, yes, it is, a renovated, repurposed armory building in Natick.
That's commercial.
It's over my time. Michelle, start to head out. We have a couple more plans loaded in, so please feel free to.
I'd rather see mailboxes inside.
What's that? Mailboxes?
Mailboxes outside.
Inside. Mailboxes inside. As opposed to having here. Right.
I love the trees.
So 77% of you said yes, you think this could be desirable and suitable for the ones with three more classes. So here's another. This is a 4-story.
Family.
What's a comment?
Too modern.
Too high. too high? Sorry?
The recess.
You like that? You like the recess? Okay. Recess number four. I'm sorry, can you speak up a little more?
The white parts look like they may be construction materials that aren't as nice as what I see that's great on the rest.
Concerned about quality of the construction?
This does not say small New England town.
Does not seem to fit with the character.
I'm not writing the power.
We're going to start the countdown. We have 10 seconds left. And Kevin Godia, please enter your vote.
It looks more modern than what we have.
So more modern, is in a good way or not a good way? Not a good way. So 79% say this would not be suitable, not fit. So this is a photo mixed-use development, retail on first floor, residential above.
Which one? The whole?
So this development actually includes a mix of apartments, townhomes, and duplexes. So we didn't show the development from different angles, so this is just one view.
So like retail on the main street and then just residential?
Yeah.
Too tall.
Too tall.
I don't think it fits that area.
Seems like it's not too much density.
Seems too dense.
I think the problem is that there's no place in that district that this scale and volume of building fits.
May not fit current density?
Yeah, it doesn't fit the area. The building itself is not bad.
In terms of height? Or
in terms of just there's too much development. You don't have any parcels that are even close to doing one quarter of that.
So you combine it, which is what would happen.
This actually, just to let you know, the density per acre of this development is actually less than 30 Haven. Just to give you an idea.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
Yeah. So I'm going to start the vote. The 10 second countdown. Let's get your vote in. This is in Arlington.
What kind of parking?
So 64% say no. Not be suitable.
Could be down in the 1A. Could be down by the depot in the 1A part.
You believe that this could potentially be suitable in the depot area?
The 1B area. Yeah.
1B area?
The 1B area.
So here's the next image. This is residential. The overhangs are good.
Yeah. Lots of windows, which is good.
Does this include parking?
No, I do not know. I know this building. This is the parking underneath. It's actually masked to look like it's.
And that's the entrance
to the
parking. Balconies. People like the balconies?
Yes.
I think the variations of the facade.
No trees.
There's a little variation.
Variation of the facade.
You like that?
Is a good thing.
I don't love the yellow, isn't it?
The color of the facade. Just like the facade, you don't like the yellow color. Okay, you start the countdown. So you can always vote again. Please enter your vote. You like the hidden parking.
The black roof is impractical.
So this is actually a little bit of a split. Both slight majority do not feel this would be a good fit.
Where is that?
This is in Beverly. Here's another development. Three-story. What are some comments? People like or dislike?
Looks cheap.
Sorry?
It
looks cheap.
It looks like a housing
tract. The height is good, though.
It's like 30 feet.
Exactly.
Just like the color.
I like that it has gardens.
like the green space, public realm, garden.
Commercial space.
This is strictly residential, right?
Yes, this is multifamily residential.
It's too monolithic.
Too monolithic. Any other comments? Can we start the countdown to get voted yes? So, Jordy, Jordy's like, no. There's another development. Also housing. Any comments?
Is this only residential?
This is residential. I hear a lot of comments, but I'm trying to capture them and repeat them for a note taker. Looks like a motel.
Is that parking or concierge?
That is actually a drive-through. There's parking on both sides. So mine is I see this building from other views.
Dislike the open
this
parking.
This is in Braintree. I'm sorry?
I dislike the open parking that it's just dislike kind of the, up on a podium and empty underneath.
Okay. Sorry? Okay. Any other comments?
I like the stone archways, the like character and the combination with the brick.
So like the stone archways, the combination with the brick. Any other comments on this one?
The space and the balcony kind of look, I don't know, unattractive. They're dark and untrendy.
Some like and some do not like the balcony.
Like very, very flat facade.
Sorry?
Dislike the flat facade.
Dislike the flat facade. Okay, so we're
going to
start the
countdown.
If you haven't voted yet, please do.
Too tall.
Too tall?
I like the pointed roofs on the front, but I don't like the flat here. I like
the preference for the pointed roofs, not the flat.
There's only one decoration. So 76%
of you guys are voting this one. So now we're going to shift gears and talk about PDA number 2, South Main Street Corridor. So we believe that there's opportunity in parcels in this area to do more mixed use with residential bus on the ground level, multifamily, and potentially some office development. An image of a device. Mix of office, businesses office? On the first floor, residential above. Like the green space? Setback seems like it's too much. So that element would not fit.
The lamp posts are really nice.
I am not sure.
I would assume, yeah. It's nice to have some open space.
Some comments? Sorry, I'm trying to get your comments one at a time. If you can speak up and make sure we can capture them.
I like the bench, the seating place, and I like the contours on the building, the different contours on the building.
So like the outdoor seating, like the contours?
Like the open space so that you can walk between different units on that second floor.
Setbacks.
Some people like setbacks, some people felt like it was a little too far.
Yeah, a little too far.
All right, let's start the countdown. If you haven't voted yet, please do. Any more comments? Make it a requirement?
South Main Street may require differentiation on the first floor for commercial. I'm not seeing buildings on the first floor on Main Street.
Could use more transparency.
Sorry, do you need the meter? I can't hear him. So he made a comment about the...
George, what did you say?
To differentiate the first floor on the necessary for the scale of Main Street.
You won't be able to drive by and know
there's not enough transparency.
I'm sorry, a comment there, was that around you feel like if you were to drive by you couldn't tell that there was retail on the first floor because of the design?
It all looks residential.
It looks residential. Do you like or not like that?
Where is that?
This is in Falmouth.
What's really attractive about this, I think, is the articulated roof line. And although it's got a fairly high density, your eye doesn't capture the kind of this monolithic roof line. It's, you know, you kind of drive by it, and for a brief second, it looks like houses, right? It's actually a multifamily high-density dwelling.
I think it also goes with the office building that we now have down there on the right hand side.
It does.
So this would fit with neighboring structures.
It makes it pleasant for walkability.
Great. So I think I will. People voted. Sorry, I missed the cat. 80% like it, right? So here's another development. This is also mixed use. Ground floor retail.
Too tall.
Procession access is too tall. Four stories. It looks stark. Looks more urban. Looks like an urban street corner.
On the north part of South Main Street, it's okay.
So on the north part of South Main Street, perhaps this is
closer
to downtown Richmond.
I like the width of the sidewalk and the crossing. Right there.
So the crossing, the street crossing, the sidewalk width?
It's going to be a signage issue too, because you've got too far
side. Okay, I'm going to start the countdown.
Signage issue.
So please vote if you haven't had a chance to yet.
Where are the signs?
This is a brand new building. We're not on it yet.
Brand new?
Yeah. It just finished just like a month ago.
Where is it?
Salem. So actually a bit of a mix. I'll send you more because this may not be a fit. So here's another development. These are actually townhomes. Perception that there are too many windows.
Too boxy.
Too boxy. It's
top heavy.
Top heavy, that's
fine. Top heavy?
I think we would need elevators for the population we want to have.
So it may not be suitable for population that has easy access to upper floors. We would need an elevator.
Well, they're townhouses, so I think that, I don't know where the parking is, so I like the fact that you don't see the parking.
Like that parking is not visible? For this particular one, I don't remember where the parking is.
These are in the rear.
This is in Weymouth at Southfield Development, which has many different development types. Okay, I'm going to start the countdown. If you haven't voted yet, please do.
It's nice that there's a parking strip. That's something we don't have on South Main.
Yes.
So I will just add that your comments that you're providing us aside from the vote are very important. That's really what we're going to rely on when we do our modeling. So it's not just a simple yes no, that it's most important to us. So you saw this image previously. Do you think this would be a fit for South Main Street?
More appropriate, yes.
More appropriate for South Main Street. You line South Main Street with buildings of that tall, carter. So concern that too many developments of this style or height with the height, flat roof, just like flat roof. I like the South Main water setback. This really comes to the speed. I don't think the speeds of cars on South Main Street would justify building strike with, you know, zero
right to the front street.
No blinkers.
Concerned about setback? Too close to the street? Not safe? Due to speed of vehicles traveling on that road curve? I'm going to start the countdown, so if you haven't voted yet, please do. 10 seconds.
One thing I think is good is the window panes, they crisscross, it's not just a big sheet glass. Thank you. I think that makes it fit with the home of the community.
So the design of the windows, you believe, makes it?
I think that's good.
The divided lights.
The divided.
They're four.
Instead of a big pane of glass, you have, you know.
Okay.
It's got too much smell.
The design in the window.
Pretty good time.
Sorry, for some reason, I skipped the timer. So, slight majority, not sure this gets to the meeting. Here's another development. This is also mixed use. It's actually, they have not filled it yet, but it's retail space on the first level and apartments above.
I like the openness of the retail on the first floor.
Like the openness of the retail on the first floor, the windows, the sense of windows.
It needs signage though, clear.
Yeah, not populated yet, so.
Needs better landscaping too.
Better landscaping, rather than new trees.
Urban looking.
Urban looking?
It doesn't have any openings. Sometimes if someone's too tall, if you think if it was like three stories or two stories or more, that's good feedback as well.
Three stories would be better.
I like the crosswalk.
Like the crosswalk?
The brick.
The brick
and the painted.
Something about the top three stories is a little too austere and sterile.
Yeah, the top story is too sterile. We're gonna start the cap down. Do you have anybody yet, please do?
I think it's another flat roof, isn't it?
Yes, this is another flat roof. So, not a fan of the flat roof.
No. I'm also not a fan of the big overhangs because bicycles is the danger on the sidewalk.
Need setback?
Need more of a setback?
The fourth floor looks like a half a block.
Okay.
The middle of.
Fourth floor does not seem to fit, so.
Where is this building?
If it were, the fourth floor had a different design, do you think? More consistent with the first three, you think maybe? Okay.
Where is this building?
Change of the fourth floor design could fit better, the four stories and that brick.
I like the detail on the brickwork.
Like the brick detail? Contrasting color?
Yeah.
The window?
Yeah.
So I'll start the countdown. Oh, sorry. So here's another development. This is actually around the corner from the other development you saw.
What's that?
Salem. This is a mixed-use development. It has ground floor retail and restaurant uses. It's right on a very busy square. A comment that it would fit very well for downtown. So you believe for downtown in addition to number sub Main Street, both?
Yeah.
You didn't show this one for downtown, so thank you for that feedback.
No. It's better. It's almost better to use the downtown.
Almost better fit for downtown than sub Main Street.
I like the curve on the corner.
Like the curve on the corner, that it's on a corner and that curve in the building?
The scale of what's behind that corner is scary.
Lots of retail.
Like that it provides a lot of retail opportunity. So I'm going to start the countdown. If you haven't voted yet, please.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Are we supposed to be just looking at this for the style of the building or the actual building?
You mean?
Because I hear a lot of talk about scale and stuff, and I'm like, I kind of get that, but I thought we were focusing more like on the style of the building. You know,
when you say style, you mean?
I mean, the various uses of materials. Yeah. Does that design fit where we want to put it? Not necessarily the size of it, because scale can come down. But if the building doesn't fit the neighborhood, then you know what I mean? It's like.
So that's a nuance that we need to know. So okay. When you say you like or don't like it, in the context of the area that we're talking about, you know, if you let us know, if it were, you know, three stories or two stories, but similar in you know, the facade design, we think that could fit. You know, that's the kind of nuance and information that we need and want.
You know, because, so, you know, I can see this fitting mm-hmm. if it were scaled appropriately.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's no corner on South Main Street.
What I'm hearing is, you know,
for several of these, the building that we're looking at is too big for the places in Reading where we could put them. But the style is nice. Mm-hmm. So there's a mixture. There's a couple of them where you can look at the building and you know that they can't build it smaller. Something like this, you could scale down. You could drop it to three stories and it would fit in a couple of different places at a smaller scale. So it's hard to juggle the good and the bad, some of them.
And the other thing about that building is if you straightened it out and had the center, in other words, instead of wrapping around the corner, it's really a nice building. But if you had the centerpiece of the building be that, you know, what is now the corner, I think it would fit down. It really is kind of an interesting building.
Yeah, imagine that thing in the middle of an atrium as you walk in.
I like the social area of it, especially when you think about how busy Main Street is, so there'd be a place to gather off of the Main Street.
There actually is outdoor seating for the restaurant facing.
I love that.
Thank you. So I know it's hard to kind of distill to a yes or no, but you know, weighing all the elements that you see that you think are appealing and that whether it could fit with some adjustments, you know, you can make your selection based on that. So. Oh, sorry. For some reason, I skipped the timer. But so next one, shifting gears to talking about PDA number 3 and crossing the road.
61. No.
Opportunities we've identified. It could be suitable to accommodate more multifamily, townhouse style, office on space. So here's an example of a commercial development. This is actually live workspace. It is artist live workspace. I know that the town has done some work in looking at the potential of adopting a cultural district, so this could be interesting to consider. So, perception of the design seems sterile.
I think it's got some variety. It has a little more of an artsy feel. It's not flat or straight. It's got
the variety of elements.
Like the variety of elements on the side, it seems. Sorry, I want to use your words.
I actually like that.
Okay.
You have an artsy flair. You've got some different kinds of things happening at the same time.
It's not
a monolithic problem. Mm-hmm. It's not monolithic.
Okay. We have 5 seconds left for more discussion.
It looks like there's some social space there, which is good. The display or gallery space.
It's a gallery space, actually, first floor. Like the social element of the use.
What about like a green space?
This is in Boston.
Cases where there's a big market basket RMLD, so I think it's a better fit for that area from any other area. You would have to choose.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we look at.
All right, so I'm
going to
start the timer. Please vote if you haven't yet. So, majority believe yes, this could be a nice style structure. So here's another example. This is also live workspace, artist live work with ground floor retail. Comments?
A little too tall.
A little too tall. Too boxy in design. Not enough windows. Too much concrete.
Especially too much on the first floor.
This light retail. Yes. So it seems like there's a lot of concrete on first level for retail.
I like the trees.
Like the trees, streetscape.
And the parking access.
Access parking.
Street lights. Sidewalk lights, sorry.
Sorry?
Sidewalk lights.
Okay. Any more comments? I'll start the timer. So please vote if you haven't yet. 10 seconds. Any other comments on this one?
Too modern.
Sorry?
Too modern.
Sorry? Okay, so majority said no on this one. So, this is the image we saw previously. Beautiful thing.
Same problem.
Same comments as provided last time on this image. Not appropriate for this person. For number three. Okay. So please vote. Comment that this is better, more appropriate here than in the other PAs, but still not one of the better development types we've seen. So
somebody earlier mentioned that the architectural element of the pink roof down there was helpful, but they don't have enough of that kind of. Now that sort of makes it less industrial looking. So if they did more of that, it might be nicer.
So perception that it would not be very safe to walk near this building due to the design of the first?
Plus, it's just isolated.
Okay, I mean the area. Agree.
I would like it better just visually if there were a brick on this, the one closest to us too, that it wasn't just in the middle.
Mm-hmm. So more of the brick facade. Yeah, what about the story?
It looks like three different developments left together.
All right, 68%, this one. This image we saw previously, what do we think about its potential fit in this area?
So what we see over here fit in all of three levels. All of three
Well, let's look at the handout. So what's the acreage on PA 103?
4 acres.
It's 5 acres?
Four acres.
So this development is actually 2.7 acres. And this one actually has 134 housing units. It has, I don't have the square footage for commercial, but it's actually on a much smaller parcel. So if you haven't voted yet, please do. Any comments?
It's good to have the mixed use. It looks nice in the retail on the front and then the residential. Nice fit.
So that
there
could be a nice fit.
Yes.
You'd have to really improve access to that area if you were going to put down a residential.
So there would be the need for infrastructure.
It's better use for offices in that
area. Perception that any mixed use development should include more office. And number three.
Well, that's what you say.
I like that bottom perspective much better than I do the side perspective. Like the architecture on the bottom picture. But looking at the top angle, it just looks so
dense. That's the rendering.
Yeah, so just to clarify, you're looking at the rendering of the big photo. The smaller inset photo is actually how it looks today. So it's much better quality. But we didn't have a shot of the whole thing, so.
So the bottom one is?
The bottom is how it really looks. It's actually just a close-up photo.
Oh, so I get one better.
It's a little bit more real. So I'm going to start the countdown. If you could, did it already fit? 68% yes, believe this could be a good fit. Noted the comment that it more office would be appropriate. townhomes. And the garages are underneath, and you have access from the back. That's what that photo shows.
Townhomes meaning that you have up and down.
So this would have been great.
A lot of stairs.
Yeah.
Jen, can we put this up in the South Main Street pit and see how people vote on it?
South Main Street?
Yeah.
I think it's very appropriate for South Main.
Yeah. Great building, wrong area.
Great building, wrong area.
I think we get a positive response if we put that up on South Main Street as an option.
Well, I'll just kind of do a majority vote because it may take us a little too long to redo the slide. Would people prefer to have this considered for South Main Street?
Yes. Okay.
So we'll consider this polling results responsible. This being suitable for South Main Street? Comments? Before
that was a good idea. Because older people were drawn to housing that had less levels because of the challenges of moving up and downstairs. So I look at this as very vertical living, which tells me it might not appeal to the growing demographic of older people unless all these units have elevators, which seems unlikely. I thought single level housing was where it was at for aging seniors.
Yes, so
that would be my concern.
Right.
That can also but that can be considered in the design because some of them are now being done where there's single family living or single level within accommodation for some other person.
Some of the other development types we're showing would include the ability to include an elevator. Some of the larger multifamilies, but yes, this is townhouse style development.
So this could not be an entrance on the side and an elevator up to a floor with this facade. It's individual.
This is individual. There are multifamily buildings that are designed to look like this, where it's bayed. That's what you call that, individual bays, to give it that variation and look. But yeah, that has been done in other places.
So increase accessibility. So this included design elements that increase accessibility.
Yeah.
It could be suitable for New Crossing Road. Okay, so if you haven't entered your vote yet, please do, and I'll start the timer.
This is actually one of those combos, where there's different levels of living, too. Some of it's multifamily, and then this is multifamily, and then there's townhouses in between. So it's kind of one of those combos.
Yeah, I have to say, this seems like a very strange location to be putting houses.
Yeah.
New Crossing Road.
Yeah, it's right on the train tracks.
It's $1 million for a one-bedroom apartment.
Concern that the uses around this area it would not be a good fit for more housing.
You're right on the train tracks.
Right on the train, being on the train tracks.
I just want to say, these all seem like they come from cities and places. Don't you have anything that's been done in a smaller town that we can see?
Newburyport's downtown.
I think that they're all really big. And I just wondered.
Do you have any pictures with two stories at all? In this deck?
I think the next one I have, I do think, is the next one here.
And I know they can be adapted somewhat, but still, they all seem really large. But the tiny ones.
Yes.
With at least two of the areas calling for at least light industrial for some of their applications, constructed most, if not all, of the applications are residential and retail.
Right.
But I haven't seen, maybe there was one
but they're not what I would call a light industrial or light manufacturing or incubator or technology type buildings. They're all single family, multi-unit, high density with retail potentially in the bottom. Do you have any of that sort? If that's a consideration for these spots.
I think in the next set, there are some actually that we put in an SPA that we could consider. So I'm going to start the polling on this one. If you have a vote again, please do.
When you do the scenarios, we will look at the street width and what if a street can have in this kind of building. You know, just look at it from the business or people on the street. How often do we have the street network and widths to support this kind of buildings? So I'm looking at it the other way around.
So our staff are working on the visualizations and renderings. We've picked, the town has asked us to look at PDA number 3 to do actually a site plan if there were to be redevelopment. So it would include looking at, you know, what would a reconfigured street network be to enable, you know, a mix of uses and a more welcoming street environment. So that's exactly what we'll be modeling.
I think most of these buildings that we're seeing in PDA 3 is more appropriate for PDA 2. South Main Street rather than the industrial
center.
When I think about young people trying to buy their first place, maybe they have a baby or maybe they don't yet, being near the train is a good thing. And that's what this strikes me as a possibility for those young families trying to get into Reading as a first place to live.
So due to the location, proximity to other assets, including the commuter rail, you feel that if there were housing with a rent, you know, site design, that this type of development could be suitable?
Yes, because I think that the younger people could also drive to maybe get to other places. It's a less good place for the seniors than it is for the younger people.
So it seems like folks have already voted. I apologize if you can't have this, but 70% did respond to no, but obviously all of your comments are noted. So this is another townhome style development. This first level where the windows are, it's actually hidden garages. So there are garages underground, but they've designed in such a way that, you know, it looks like it's a part of the
wrong location.
Considering that this is not an appropriate location, that could accommodate
the same thing.
Not a bad building, but a bad.
Do you think this could fit in other places where we may have
South Main?
If you haven't voted yet, please do. I'll screen the hands down. So concerned that this residential would not be necessarily the best fit for this current
development. Now this parcel, you want to keep it commercial, perhaps so limited. We have such limited areas in town. You would want to move something from the commercial to residential.
Okay, 72%. So now we're shifting gears. So we're now shifting gears to PDA number 401 General Way, the largest parcel of all the 30 development areas. So we've identified this area as being suitable for build-to-suit office space, mixed use, and also multifamily and single-family townhome style development. One General Way is a very large parcel, currently site of, you know, a lot of single-story development, a lot of parking.
What is this? Is this an apartment building?
This is offices.
How many floors is that?
Four stories. Five.
It's nice in terms of scale, I think, about a big parcel, but it doesn't seem like it's big very much. It's kind of a blob.
Seems like that.
Very square.
Very square, yes. Sorry, I'm trying to capture your comments, so if you want what they want us to record, just speak up.
This is five stories, isn't it?
Five stories, yes, my mistake.
And there's no residential in that?
No residential, it's all office. So due to the size of this parcel, it is possible they can accommodate multiple different development types and structures with different uses, so just keep that in mind.
You're looking at this like sitting on top of some of the present buildings there?
This is actually two stories on top of the two-story structure.
So I'm gonna start the cat down, so if you want to vote again. I think I know what people are gonna vote.
I really love that cat.
Actually, I like the two different materials on the side, like that, and the design. Comment that it seems like it's getting a lot of use. They're obviously a lot of cars there.
I don't know what they're doing, but they're there.
There are a lot of businesses in there. So, actually, wow, the majority actually voted yes, that this could be suitable. Here's another office.
Lots of windows, techie feel to it, like lots of different kinds of tenants, the door side.
Like the techie feel, like the windows.
I like the reuse of historic buildings.
Yeah, like the reuse of the historic brick structure. Like the blend of traditional and modern elements. It needs more open space?
More green space.
The actual property has a large proportion of protected wetlands. So the actual, the available area is smaller than the vertical wetlands.
So if our redevelopment were to happen, obviously taking note of the environmental constraints and preservation priorities within that person. So please vote if you haven't yet.
I haven't seen any solar roofs or anything like that yet. Is that something we can put a vote in for?
Yes. We did not grab a photo of that, but please note that energy, solar roofs. Thank you. So majority believe yes, this type of dwelling could be suitable, and we're done all way. So here's this development again. We don't need to discuss it if your comments are the same. No, this is a different priority development area, much larger parcel. Comments?
This is the first time we've had enough space to deal with it.
The first time we've dealt with a parcel that there's a hope that this could actually fit.
I think that's a good place for seniors because of access to Market Basket.
Good place if this includes residential smaller units so that it increases opportunities for seniors, housing opportunities for seniors,
which means
proximity to supermarket.
Which means it can't be three floors out of one townhouse.
Yeah.
That's
is the northeast corner of this general way that's shown wooded, is that really buildable?
No.
No, it's not.
So why is it
not?
Why is it not?
I'm sorry.
If it's not buildable, why is it in the district?
We're selecting the parcel, so it's the parcel. So that's parcel level information. But when we get to the level of actual recommendations of what's actually possible within each of the PDAs, we'll prioritize, parts of parcels or, specific parcels in larger areas.
We can subtract the wetlands.
Should we skip over the residential side?
I think what I'm hearing is residential is
Nobody's really too crazy about it. Should we skip over and go to the, just the images that are commercial for?
Yeah.
Before there's a lynching, right?
So it looks like most of you have voted already, so I'll finish this one. This is Running Woods. I'm going to go to the countdown. To skip. Want to skip this one? Want to skip it?
Skip.
Skip this one?
Skip.
Looks cheap.
I'm not dead yet.
So Do you know where this is?
I think the concept of that is nice.
The concept of outdoor seating for restaurants is nice. Wanting more of that?
The execution is
okay. Now we have the opposite problem. I don't know how you say not many of these, because in some degree they're all good. So I'm not. As you go through these amenities, is it literally just yes or no, or is it?
Well, you know, we can talk about sort of where you'd like to see more of this. So, you know, when you see this, you know, more in PDA number one, you know, where there may be more retail restaurant uses. So you can talk about sort of where you want to see more of this, where you think there's more opportunity. Matt?
Let's say, like, you know, if you like the greenery, if you like the fact that there's outdoor seating, it's just kind of what elements about that individual image do you like? And then if this is more about the context and what the notes we're taking here than it is really about the yes or no.
Yeah. So really, this is where your comments are really supplementing yes or no.
I'd like a little more privacy borders. Like there's greenery on one side and there's the fence with low flowers, but I would almost want a little more privacy.
Privacy if there's housing next door, so that there's more of a...
Or even to the main street.
Even to a main street, so people are enjoying dinner.
Is that a picture
dinner.
In front of you, but...
Sorry.
What's the high?
Here's a storefront with planting, a nice brick facade.
And flowers.
Blade side.
Seats are nice.
Outdoor seating. Plantings are nice.
It'd be nice to have open windows in restaurants.
Having open, more open windows in restaurants downtown. Yeah,
those are the restaurants would be great.
I like the corner signs.
Yeah. What do you see downtown?
Like the signs.
The awnings.
The awnings.
The street lights.
Like the street lights.
Scale.
I like the weather.
Another view of a storefront that has large windows for seating, similar to the last one. Larger windows.
Variations
of the sides on the street.
The flowers are pretty. How hard is it to keep them alive?
Maintaining. Well, you know, it depends. For something like this, some of businesses, it's
the benches.
Business
nice.
Owner will have to have a budget for that.
The benches. And the outdoor seating. Nice.
Benches. Wanting a wider sidewalk, this is too narrow. This is actually a big con next door bookstore. The bookstore made use of that space next door. They may actually own that place. What do people think about this type of? You don't think of a bookstore? How does this type of use measure up for retail? This is the there's also public art in this image, so it's not just about the
I mean, nice to have a little bit of open space for playing music.
Okay. So this would be simple space. You're having open space for music, entertainment. Okay. Any other comments? space, you know, activity space.
For one, for 1A and 1B.
More of this type of open space for 1A?
For 1A and 1B.
More of that in 1A?
I don't think we need more pillars. I don't think we need more of the stone pillars.
Those are for safety, but the perception that they're not attractive.
No, I don't think they're safe.
Public art. Especially at Welcome Sign, one community. What's up Main Street being, you know, for example, one of the corridors that people enter the town. Thoughts?
I love that idea. It's nice. Nice idea. It's done well.
Like the idea of this kind of public art?
Yeah.
It could work.
And I think engaging the students in the schools and the public art.
Opportunity to do
very welcoming. Great.
Welcoming. It's a welcoming. Yeah. Great.
Just sit near you and Kim.
Just to recap, we're using the information you gave us tonight to inform our work in doing renderings for PA number 1 and number 3, which are the two the town has prioritized. We're also going to use the feedback you gave us about density and mix of uses for all the different PDAs to inform the modeling. We'll generate a couple of different modeling scenarios we'll do for each site. So when you come back again, which I hope you do on June 3rd, in this location, we'll share the findings from that and also some recommendations of short and long-term action items for you to consider. So please save the date. We'll be back in this location. I will, if you signed up when you came in, I will make sure to email you an invitation to that meeting. And any last comments? We are over our time, so I apologize, but thank you for staying. If you have any last comments, feel free to come up to any of us.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you. You're great. Thanks for making the time. We'll enjoy it.
I have to figure out how I want to spend my time.
Trust me, you'll find things.
I know. You will. People are retired. You know how it is.
Every bit. Here you go.